Nora Amsalem, and I'll be singing Mimi here at the New Orleans Opera. And I actually came from home right now, Berlin, because I have a 6-year-old son that I had to see in between all the things that I do. So I have to leave some little time to go home and see my son.
My name is Noah Stewart, and I'm singing the role of Rodolfo here at New Orleans. And recently completed my debut, Espoused, Atlanta Opera, and it's really wonderful to be here. And
I recently sang Traviata in Warsaw and Amelia al Ballo in Monte Carlo with Maestro Domingo conducting, which was a different experience for me since I've sung with him and this was the first time he was conducting. And the reason why I became an opera singer is that I was actually in a children's chorus from 9 to 15 years old in France, which is called La Maîtrise de Radio France. And we used to do normal studies half of the day and musical studies the other half of the day. And I also used to be a harpist. And that children's chorus was a professional children's chorus. So we did a lot of things like the Carmen with Domingo singing and Julia Mingenes Johnson, the movie. And we'd also did the chorus of Bohème with Carreras and Barbara Hendricks. And we did a lot of concerts. We did Parsifal with Jesse Normans, and those are just little examples of that. So my passion was singing, and I love to do that. And after that, I met my voice teacher, who's Lorraine Nubar in the south of France. And she brought me to the States. So then I went to Princeton University, entered the Metropolitan Opera competition that I won, and then I did the Young Artists Program at the Met, and that was the beginning of it all.
Well, like Nora, I had my beginning in singing choir.
Oh,
music came
you.
To me, and I wanted to become an engineer because I love math, I love science, and I remember one day on the loudspeaker it said, "Does anyone want to join choir?" And they always needed men. I mean, sopranos, they always had sopranos and kind of soprano twos, no? But they didn't have any men, and some of my friends, we went down and joined, and I was the only one that stayed after a week of choir because they didn't think it was very cool. They thought playing soccer and basketball was cool. I thought playing soccer and basketball, I think it's cool as well, but there was this something that I got from singing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel the same way that you didn't get from,
oh, sure,
from math and science?
Absolutely. It's just such a visceral art, and that it has to come from within and from your heart, and it's just not the same.
Yeah, the things that we can't describe as things that we can't write down.
Exactly.
We sing.
You have to express it that way.
Yeah,
exactly.
and to fire up, and one of my first competition, it was strange, one of my first competition when I was about, let's say, 12 years old,
and
I didn't really know what competition was, but I was singing and really enjoying myself, and my choir teacher said, "I think you have what it takes to become an opera singer," and I thought, an opera singer, wow, that sounds kind of strange. I went home and told my mom, I said, "Ma, I want to become an opera singer," and she's like, "Opera?" She's like, "What, you know, who? Opera?"
So what's your real job going to be?
Exactly. And so she wasn't really excited about me becoming a musician, but she supported me. You know, I was very lucky. And then I went to LaGuardia High School, which is sort of like, did you go to an arts high school?
Well, I went to this kind of special school where you did normal studies in the morning and half of your day was spent studying music and doing choral work, and I played the harp, and, you know, we did all those things.
It was the same. We had the same experience. Did you have any other genres of music that you studied, or was it
No,
classical music?
Just classical.
Yeah. And we had a mix. We had a strange mix of gospel, jazz, musical theater.
That's good.
Yeah, it was kind of cool. But it was also hard because I was the one that stuck out. In fact, they used to call me Opera Boy. Because most of my friends wanted to become pop singers.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I got into opera, really. I fell in love with opera when I first heard it because I thought it was the perfect art form in terms of acting and singing and also blending of languages.
Okay.
Because I didn't grow up speaking other languages, and I was so excited to first study.
Your Italian is so good.
Thanks.
Thanks.
I studied Italian in high school, but I was so excited to blend the two. I thought that was so challenging. And when did you first sing? Do you ever sing in English?
Very little.
Mm.
In college, right? Or in university, whatever you call it.
What language do you sing in the most, would you say?
Italian and French.
Yeah.
And German is not my opinion.
Neither me. And after high school, I went to Juilliard in New York, and being a New York baby, I just wanted to stay around my friends and my family, and
it's a great city.
Yeah.
So
fun. Like Berlin. We're mixed and crazy and
a bit, but New York has everything's there at your feet that you would want.
Yeah, and it was always really lucky.
Everybody transits through New York. So.
Actually, a lot of friends who were in the choir did kind of choir things with the Met as well, like in the children's chorus. So it was, we had a really fortunate experience. I was an opera nerd, I would probably say. One thing led to another, and you know, it snowballed, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And I went to AVA, Academy of Vocal Arts, for a year, and then I went to San Francisco Opera, and I was in the Young Artist Program, and that's when my career really started.
I think Mimi is a very sweet character, and she's probably very lonely, and she sits there in her little room and makes her flowers and embroiders or whatever, and I think she sees those guys through her window, and they're having so much fun, you know.
Oh yeah.
And she sits there and she's kind of lonely, and you know, she wants somehow to be part of that too, even though her character is not portrayed in the opera, I think, as it is in the book, because in the book she's a lot more courtesan, she has a lot more of the courtesan side, which we don't see really in the opera, because it's rarely mentioned, or it's hinted at but not really portrayed obviously. And so I think she is kind of lonely, and she sees all that fun, and when she can, she definitely seizes the opportunity to try, and she sees you, you know, and she's like, oh, well.
How could she not be? Kidding.
So she goes and knocks on the door, and, you know, and hopes that that will bring her some joy and some fun. And
Does she have many friends? This is one of the questions I never...
No, I don't think so.
Yeah.
I don't think so, because the way you lived in those days, for her anyway, I think she, you know, she sit on her ways of earning money was or embroidering or doing those flowers or being a courtesan. That was it.
Yeah.
You know, so. And I don't think, it doesn't seem like anyway she has a lot of friends. She's not like Musetta.
Yes.
Who has,
she's shy.
Yeah, I think she has more of an integrity.
Hmm. Yeah, and I fall, as Rodolfo, the poet, I fall in love with that immediately. I mean, Rodolfo is probably my favorite role because it's just, I think you can only be young once, and I think we all remember what it's like to be young and to cherish the things that are special and most dear, which is friendships and love. Mm-hmm. And Rodolfo is just, I think, the quintessential part, also because he's romantic. I mean, every tenor wants to be a romantic lead,
right,
or like,
sure.
Or even like in a play or a book, everyone wants to be kind of the dashing lead. That but it's quite interesting, his relationship with the other boys, his friends in the story, because he has three other friends: Chenard, Colline, and Marcello, his best friend. And it's interesting how they all have different character traits, but Rodolfo is really the poet, the one who I think seeks truth. And I think when he meets Mimi, it's sort of like a match made in heaven, would you say?
Right, and she's also a poet, I think,
yeah,
in some ways, and that's what connects them, is their romantic, poetic side that they both have.
Which is so sweet. I mean, I've just been thinking so much about love these days these months, because I think so many of my friends have gotten married, or maybe it's because it's spring, or just springtime for lovers, and but I think it's a real blessing and a special thing to find someone that you love.
Sure.
And that kind of, and I always ask.
It's so rare, I think, to find your true soulmate, and to, when you do, you feel so blessed.
Yeah, I agree. And it's almost like Mimi and Rodolfo, they can almost finish each other's sentences.
Right.
Because they're just on such the same wavelength, and they have such the same passions in terms of, but also very fiery in terms of, I think.
Well, you are.
But so are you. No.
It's okay.
But I think that's it's quite normal in a relationship, don't you? And
yeah.
In terms of having ups and downs and
of course. It's normal.
Because it brings and it makes it so much sweeter, like in Act 3, when we have seemingly broken up and gotten back together,
mm-hmm.
but we decide to get back together one last time.
Right.
Till April, till it's warm again.
Yeah, because we still enjoy each other's company so much. And arguably, you're my true love.
Yeah. What I think is great in this cast is that we're all having a lot of fun in the rehearsals.
Yeah. And the food hasn't arrived yet.
I know.
That's
Especially in Act 2, and you know, and I think that creates some bonds, and it's very important, I think, in this piece to have that kind of complicity.
Mm. I'm enjoying the process thoroughly as well, because, I mean, opera, again, is about theater, and one of the things you must have in any, I think, any production of a theater production is must have an equal understanding of and respect for each other in terms of artists. And De La Bohème is very unique in that it is an ensemble show. So it's
right.
it's dependent upon everyone in the cast. I mean, there are seven of us in the or eight
yeah.
cast members in the show. There are four guys. There are five men, arguably, plus
well,
one.
There's yeah,
Alcindoro
and Benoit are two different people in the show.
So it's six guys and two ladies. And chorus and children, so it's a huge ensemble, and we're on stage a lot with each other. Well, I don't think there's ever a time. I think Rodolfo is the only person alone, and he's alone maybe about, I don't know, maybe 6 seconds, and then it's just me. So it's we're really dependent upon each other and the support, and we have fun. We have fun and we play, and I think that's the key to having a great chemistry. And
right.
I've never met Nora before, but I've heard amazing things about you.
Me too.
And thank you. And we met and we instantly got on. And for those of you watching who don't know the process of opera, it's kind of unique. Wouldn't you say, Nora?
Yeah, it is. And I think it's great to have that. You know, it's not always the case. You don't always meet people that you click with or that you get along with right away. And I think when that happens, it makes them for something very special.
Because it's also we meet, we're strangers, and then we instantly, I mean, by the third day, I was already kissing Nora. So it's like you have to be comfortable, and you have to have trust between
right.
your friends and the respect with your colleagues. And it's a really nice experience. I think also being here in New Orleans is a great experience. You are from Paris.
Right.
And how would you describe, is there a similarity between Paris and maybe...
But I think from what I saw, because we went to the French Quarter.
Yes.
On two occasions, one by night and one by day, which was totally different, I must say. And there is a kind of a atmosphere that you find in the Marais Quarter in Paris today.
Mm.
It's all those little boutiques that do all different things, and it's very charming, and it's not like that by night by any means. I mean, a little bit in summer, but not comparable to what you have here. but there is this kind of charming atmosphere that you find here.
But couldn't you totally imagine, for instance, Act 2 is Christmas Eve. Couldn't you imagine the same energy would you say they're comparable in terms of Act 2 to the French Quarter here in New Orleans?
Yeah.
I mean
that's
a great part about being here in New Orleans. And is this your debut here?
Yeah.
It's my debut as well at New Orleans Opera, and it's not so far to imagine what it's like being these characters, because it's almost like it's the second city to Paris,
right.
if you will, being here.
Yeah, it was very lively and very Act 2-ish.
Yeah, and the cast that we have, it's a very young group of musicians, and they're so fantastic. They're world-class singers. The director, Christine, is unbelievable.
Yeah,
Maestro Robert is just so great. He's done the piece, I think.
Yeah, a lot, and he's very knowledgeable, and it's very nice to work with them.
Yeah,
one, two, three.
Welcome.
Welcome, everybody.
Yes, you must come to see La Bohème.
It's going to be a great show, and you're going to thoroughly enjoy it.
We're in it, so that should already be enough incentive. No, but it's exciting. They're children, they're clowns.
It's festive.
It's amazing. It's a story about love, romance, friendship, and come out and tell your friends and your family.
Yeah.